Okay, so it's my pleasure to introduce to you the next speaker, Dr. Stefan Mortensen from University of Southern Denmark, who will talk about the effect of sympatholysis. Please.
Okay, thank you, Ulva, and thank you for inviting me to speak at this symposium. So I'm going to talk about functional sympatholysis in relation to cardiovascular disease, but also I will bring up the aging process and the effect of aging on functional sympatholysis. So I will start to talk about a little bit what is functional sympatholysis and how do we measure it. Then I will talk about functional sympatholysis in aging, in hypertension, and in chronic heart failure. And then lastly, about the effect of exercise on functional sympatholysis. So this is the traditional way we look at the local vascular conductance in the skeletal muscle, as Ulva brought up. On one side, we have the vasodilators, and on the other side, we have sympathetic vasoconstriction. And we view the conductance as a balance between the two. But we also know that some of these substances are capable of actually directly blocking the effect of sympathetic vasoconstriction. So they don't block the release of norepinephrine, but they block the effect of norepinephrine. And we don't know which compound it is. There's probably more than one. In animal studies, there's a lot of evidence suggesting that it's nitric oxide, but in humans, it's much more unclear, and actually, we don't really know. So this is two examples of studies demonstrating functional sympatholysis in the exercising leg. This is a study by Søren Strange. He had young subjects perform three bouts of exercise, leg exercise, and in one bout he added static hand grip exercise, and in another one he added static hand grip exercise plus forearm ischemia with the purpose of elevating sympathetic nerve activity. So those are the red bars here. And you can see that there's no change in blood flow to the leg, indicating that this increased sympathetic vasoconstrictor does not have an effect in the leg. And actually, blood flow tends to go up, and this is because blood pressure goes up. This is another example by Gabriela Savar. They performed one-legged exercise, and then they added more and more limbs, again, to increase the sympathetic nerve activity. Here expressed as noradrenaline spillover, and again you can see there's no effect on blood flow to the exercising leg. So these are two examples of how we can evaluate functional sympatholysis. I'll just bring up three more. One way is doing lower body negative pressure. So this is a closed chamber, and basically you can add a vacuum cleaner to suck out the air of this closed chamber and reduce the pressure. This will take some of your central blood volume down to the lower limb and unload your bowel receptors and increase sympathetic nerve activity, as shown here. Another way is doing the cold pressor test. So here you submerge the hand or the foot into ice water, and this will increase your sympathetic nerve activity, as shown here. Usually you do this for about 3 minutes. And then you can perform exercise with the other arm, or if it's a leg, with the arms. The way we do this in our lab is by using Tyramine. We can infuse Tyramine into the artery, and Tyramine stimulates the release of norepinephrine from the nerve terminals. So this is a local effect, and by doing this we can keep it, the effect, within the leg. This has the advantage that it's not a systemic effect, so we don't get the same increase in blood pressure, which can be a confounding factor, and we can use the other leg as a control leg. So this is an example of where we have used Tyramine. We've created, or Jai Rosemeyer created, three hyperemic conditions in the leg, either by infusing adenosine, ATP, or having the subjects perform exercise, as shown here. And then we superimpose Tyramine, and you can clearly see there's a reduction in blood flow with adenosine, but not with ATP and not with exercise. So we say that adenosine is not a sympatholytic agent, but ATP is, And in this case, these young subjects have intact functional sympatholysis because tyramine does not have an effect. So, I start by going to the aging. It's very clearly been shown that as we get older, we have a lower blood flow response to exercise. This was first shown by John Warren from Sweden in the 70s and has been confirmed many times. So these are elderly subjects and these are young, and you can see the lower response. And the question is, could this be caused, at least in part, by an impaired functional sympatholysis? And there are many, many studies showing that in elderly inactive, you find as impaired sympatholysis. So this is a cycling with the cold pressor reflex, young and elderly men. We can see that there's a larger decline in the leg vascular conduction in the elderly compared to the young. And also this is data using tyramine. In the arm, we found that they find that the magnitude of sympatholysis is impaired in the elderly. So they use tyramine, and one tricky thing, as I usually say about tyramine, is that if you infuse the same amount of tyramine into different subjects, you might not get the same response. So elderly people, and this is a general finding, is that if you infuse tyramine, you have a larger release of norepinephrine. This, of course, can be a confounding factor in when you analyze the data. But also note that even though they have a higher release, they actually have a lower response. So when we get older, we have a reduced sensitivity to norepinephrine. We'll get back to that later. So this is some of the first data coming out on patients on hypertensive. And as you see here, they use the lower body negative pressure. And it's hand grip exercise, and they measure tissue oxygenation by NIRS. So here we have a normal tensive subject and a hypertensive subject, hand grip exercise and lower body negative pressure. You can see that there's a reduction in the tissue oxygenation in the hypertensive subject, but not in the normal tensive. So this indicates that there's a lower blood flow in the hypertensive, and they therefore have an impaired functional sympatholysis. So we have performed a similar study in hypertensives, but in the leg. This is some of the data that Ulve also referred to. And one of the first thing you have to note is that these are the normal tensive and the hypertensive. The hypertensive subjects actually have a lower blood flow during leg exercise compared to the normal tensives, even though they have a higher blood pressure and therefore a higher perfusion pressure. They have a lower blood flow because of a lower vascular conductance. And we then infuse tyramine, those are the striped bars. And as you can see here, there's no difference between the normal tensives and hypertensives regarding the reduction in flow induced by tyramine. So it does not appear in the leg that there's an impaired functional sympatholysis in hypertensives. So this is in contrast to what was previously shown in the arm. And I think as Ulve also brought up, one of the things we note here is that these subjects are about 40 to 50 years old. If you have been living an inactive lifestyle and you get to that age, then we already see many of the same deteriorations as we see in elderly in the leg. So this appears that the legs are more affected by the aging process. So, for the leg, does that mean that functional sympatholysis is not important? Maybe, but what we have to remember is that when these patients, they exercise, they have a higher sympathetic response to exercise. So they have an exaggerated exercise pressor reflex. So if you are hypertensive and you have increased sympathetic nerve activity and you have a not complete functional sympatholysis, this will have a greater effect on your muscle perfusion. Or you will impair it more, so this will have an effect on the oxygen delivery, increase your anaerobic metabolism, And we know that many of these byproducts, such as lactate and reduced pH, they are stimulators of sympathetic nerve activity. And then you get into this vicious cycle that will have consequences for your performance, you can say, or during a daily life, you will fatigue more easily. So one could say that if you are a patient with increased sympathetic nerve activity, it's even more important to have an intact functional sympatholysis. So this is example for chronic heart failure. You see the same reduction in flow in these patients. And this is, they also have this exaggerated exercise pressor reflex, here shown as noradrenaline spillover. And this is some very, very preliminary data from Gregers Munch on chronic heart failure patients. I just got them yesterday, showing that when we infuse tyramine, they have a reduction in blood flow, indicating that there could be impaired functional sympatholysis. So, what is the effect of exercise training? This is from a study with young subjects, where we measured them in a control condition. We then trained the one leg for 5 weeks, and 3 weeks into the training, we put the other leg in a cast, and then measured them after the 5 weeks. So this is during exercise at the same workload, and this is with tyramine. And you can clearly see that in the leg that has been immobilized, there's the greatest reduction in blood flow, indicating that immobilization impairs functional sympatholysis. And although it's not statistically significant, there seems to be a trend that with exercise training it's improved. The problem in this study is that when these subjects were put in a cast, even though we were still training them, when you have a cast on, you cannot use your bicycle anymore and you get more inactive. So probably the training stimulus that we imposed was not great enough to compensate for this change in lifestyle. So that might explain why we don't see a difference. So this is from another study where we have taken young Danish men that are not participating in any sports, but they bicycle every day. And we have then compared them to elderly men that have lived an inactive lifestyle. So the problem is that if you have been inactive your whole life, then you're not healthy when you reach the age of 60. So the ones that we have included are probably the ones that maybe had a dog and have been a little bit active, but not participated in sports. And then our last group have been very, very active elderly men. So this is back in the 70s, where there was something called a 100-kilometer time trial at the Olympics. And these guys, this is one of our subjects, is still training, so they have been training a lot, as much as you can, I would say. So when we have them exercise, this is the young, the sedentary and the active, and infused tyramine, the striped bars, it's very clear to see that the trained elderly have complete intact functional sympatholysis, and it appears to be even better than the young subjects, whereas the inactive elderly have impaired functional sympatholysis. So one of the problems we face when we do these experiments is that when you train, you have a lower blood flow response to exercise in the trained state. And we think of this as a good thing because we get more capillaries, we get better at extracting oxygen, so we have a lower blood flow, and it's a good thing. But when we talk about patients, we see it as an impairment, a bad thing. And how do you separate the two? Because you can see the sedentary and the trained, they don't have a different response. It's the same blood flow, there's no difference. But it's, as you can see here, they have a lower leg oxygen uptake and they're releasing a lactate, whereas the trained, they appear to be taking up lactate when they're exercising. So this is, I think, clearly shows that this is an impairment and this would be a good thing. So as I showed in the beginning, when we get older, we have a different response to tyramine. So one could speculate that this difference is caused by the fact that they have a greater norepinephrine release when we infuse tyramine. But note that this is independent of the training state. It occurs in both elderly groups. So if this is the case, then it's even more impressive that these active elderly have complete intact functional sympatholysis. So ATP, as I showed in the beginning, is one of the compounds that is sympatholytic and that we're interested in. It might be a player in mediating this. So when we infuse ATP with or without tyramine, we find that ATP is still sympatholytic, whether you are sedentary elderly or trained elderly, there's no difference. But you have a lower response, vasodilator response, if you have been sedentary your whole life. And there's newer data showing that red blood cells from elderly, they are poor at releasing ATP. And during forearm exercise, they have lower plasma ATP levels. So if you combine that you have lower plasma ATP levels in your bloodstream and the ATP that you have a lower response, that could be a mechanism explaining the impaired functional sympatholysis. And that's how we think. So this is from the hypertensives I showed before, and we trained them for 8 weeks, as Ulva said, high intensity exercise. What is important to see is that after the training period, they have complete intact functional sympatholysis. So it's restored by only 8 weeks of exercise training in both the normal tensives and the hypertensives. And importantly, after this 8 weeks of exercise training, there's no difference in the blood flow response after between the two groups. So this seems to be restored. And what might the mechanism be? Well, what is interesting to note is that if you infuse tyramine after the training period, the same amount, then you have a lower vasoconstrictor response. So it seems that you get less sensitive to norepinephrine in the trained state. And it's not caused by a difference in the tyramine effect, it's caused by a lower stimulus. So this might be a mechanism that's at least in part contributing to the beneficial effect of exercise training. So, to sum it up, functional sympathysis is impaired with aging in both the arm and the leg, that's been shown many times. And in hypertensive individuals, it appears to be impaired in the arm, but not the leg. And exercise training improves functional sympatholysis, no matter what your age, and also in hypertensives. And there's this reduction in the vasoconstrictor response to norepinephrine in the trained state, which could in part explain the beneficial effect of exercise training. So thank you for your attention. And now take questions.
Questions? Well, I can start, maybe.
It was very clear what I said, so no questions.
Yeah, it was very clear. So we always talk about NO and ATP being potential candidates for sympatholysis, but are there other, as you can see, could there be other candidates that you can think of that could be worthwhile looking at?
I think prostacycline has not really been investigated, so that's a potential candidate. And I mean, that's my opinion. There's a lot of evidence in humans suggesting that it's not nitric oxide, but there's also very clear data from animal models showing that it is. So that's something that still needs to be investigated. Of course, we know ATP is sympatholytic, but it's so far it's purely speculative whether it plays a role or not.
Thank you. Yeah, Danny.
Sorry. To what extent, Stefan, is the aging effect just dependent on muscle change? You know, deterioration in muscle size, quality, production of metabolites?
Yeah. I mean, that's the limitation in our human model that we measure global flow. We cannot measure microcircular respiratory blood flow. I think if we could, we could get a better indication. I think it might be the distribution that's really important. So the if we have intact functional sympatholysis, we are better at distributing our blood flow within the exercising model. But of course, that's really difficult to show in the models that we have. Then we have to go to a PET scanner.
Yes.
Thank you, Katarina Stedding-Ehrenborg from Lund University. You showed some data on heart failure patients and sympatholysis, and I was wondering, have you also looked at the central effects? Have there been any beneficial effects on the cardiac function from better sympatholysis?
The data I showed is actually from a training project, but they're training now, so I don't have the post data. So we're looking at it right now, but we have not done so.
Thank you.
Yes. Oh, okay, sorry. Yeah, you start.
Just wondering, the blood pressure goes up with age and then sympatholysis is impaired. Is that related? And is it harder to reduce blood pressure with training as we get older?
I think the last question, I think Ulva might be better at answering than me. But certainly if you have impaired functional sympatholysis, that would contribute to the blood pressure increase.
Do you want me to answer the other one? I mean, I think that they will be harder than a younger person, but it's still, I mean, the effect is still there in age. So it's just a matter of, you know, different modulatory levels. Yeah. So it shouldn't prevent anybody from exercising in old age. Same as with the postmenopausal women and the hypertensives. May take a little longer to get your effect. It's going to be there. That's the answer.
So you showed that exercise training improved functional sympatholysis. Is the effect systemic or local? Only local, because Danny Green showed that if you train the legs, you can improve FMD in the arms. So what can you tell?
It's a very, very good question. And we haven't looked at it, but we should have. I think it might be systemic, but we don't have the data. But it's a very, very good question, very relevant. Yeah, but then we've imposed intervention on both legs. It would be difficult to show, I think.
But that showed a localized effect, right? One leg was better, the other leg was
worse. Yeah, but we don't know if there was an effect of the exercise training on, let's say, the right leg, whether that restored some of the impairment of the immobilization. We have no way of saying that. I mean, if they had not trained one leg and the other leg had just been a cast, it might have been a greater deterioration in functional sympatholysis. So
yeah, but the point is that there's a difference between them, so it must be local.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Questions? I have another question, if I may. So, of course, when you use Tyramine, as you also allude to, is that you're looking at the plasma sympatholytic compounds. So how do you see the sympatholysis occurring from the luminal side versus the interstitial side?
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's one of the problems, or the limitations, I think, of Tyramine, is that we're stimulating the nerve terminals that are facing the lumen. I don't think Tyramine is crossing to the luminal side and has an effect there. Actually, we've measured it, we cannot detect the changes in the interstitium. Whether it's different if you stimulate the interstitium, I don't know. I don't think anyone has looked at it. So it's difficult to answer.
It'd be interesting to have a model for that, I think.
Yeah.
Probably.
It's difficult to solve.
Figure something out. Other questions? Yeah. And thank you very much. Have fun. And I would like to thank Danny Green and Stefan Mortensen for their excellent presentations, and thank you all for joining us for this session, and have a continued good day. Thank you.